Good morning, everyone. As we gather in worship, we look upon our Christ candle. It reminds us of God's presence and love for all people. As we look upon its light and our small peace candle beside it, we remember that it is only as we break down the walls that divide us and truly come to honor one another that we will be part of God's reign of peace. Welcome to South Shore United Church. Special greetings to visitors who are here with us and to those who are joining us online. Thank you for choosing us as part of your worship experience today. The bulletins are given in loving memory of Tilly Bolter, remembered by the family, and in loving memory of Blois Melvine Oakes, remembered by Lowell and Suzanne Oakes and family. We have our special community remembrance service this afternoon at 2 o'clock at the Crapo Community Hall. If anyone would like to join us as part of the choir, you are welcome to join us at that service up on the stage to help in leading the singing. There will be a short reception time offered by the community after that service as well. There are other services this week. South Shore Villa has a remembrance service on the 9th, and on the 11th there is a community service in Borden. I'm sure there are others in other communities, so you can follow those along. On November the 10th, you are invited to join with Mary Poppins and the Tryon Women's Institute in the Remembrance Day ceremony at the Tryon People's Cemetery. It is a very simplified experience so that it reaches to the level of the children and helps them in their understanding of this time of year. Next Sunday is our memorial song service. Spread the word. It's next Sunday for the memorial song service. The week after will be the all ages family-focused service. So that's a little bit of a shift from month to month. So notice it's next week for the musical service. So bring along friends and neighbors and remind others that is a special time that we share together. Thank you is extended from Mary Poppins to the Halloween volunteers who helped to add to the joy of the day for the children in daycare last week. So thank you to those who volunteered. It did create lots of fun for the little ones that day. There are no meetings this week, but you can see from the list, lots are coming up. So please take note of them and mark them on your calendar for the rest of November. There is no coffee and conversation, you'll notice, this Tuesday, which we've regularly been having. Instead, this week, you are invited to a talk on the War Memorial Trail, which is Tuesday morning at 10:30, and that is hosted by Peter and Daria Volkenberg at the community hall. We have been blessed in our church family to have some new babies join our midst over this past year, and we invite you, if you would like to contribute to some welcome bags that I take to welcome those new babies and to support the families at this time. Simple items like baby wipes, bibs, onesies, any simple things like that can be a simple way for us to say welcome to our church family. There are other announcements at the end and posted online. Please take note of those for this week. We are a treaty people. We have a treaty of peace and friendship with the Mi'kmaq people of Epiquet. With respect, we acknowledge that we live, work, play, and worship on land that is on ceded Mi'kmaq territory. May we live in love with all people who find their home in this place. And let us call one another to worship and to love. As we speak these words of our call to worship, and your parts are in bold print. We wake to a world of beauty and catastrophe, a world of vision and violence, compassion and cowardice. We live in such a wounded world. Beyond the grief of natural disasters, we face the devastation of human violence. We struggle to know how to respond. We sing, we pray, we share our grief, and we listen for God's Spirit to guide us. Let us sing a hymn for remembrance. It is the hymn, God as with Silent Hearts. We sing our remembrance and we pray our remembrance before God as we share in our opening prayer. Let us pray together. On this Remembrance Sunday, we remember our veterans, lives lost and lives altered by the mark of war. We remember places around our world still trapped in a cycle of war and violence. O God, you sent us, the Prince of Peace, to teach us your way, but we are slow to learn and quick to forget. Help us to remember that small acts joined together shape society. Remind us of the dangers of hateful words and mean actions. Guide us to acts of love and kindness that will shape a society of justice and mercy, security and peace for all. For we continue to pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. When I was visiting a week or so ago, a person showed me this in their house. Does anyone know what this is? It is a shell from World War I. And when you feel the weight of it, we can imagine the destruction it caused as it was sent forth. And we're challenged to look at ways we can transform and change destructive patterns that continue in our world. And the person who had it in their home was using it as a vase instead. They also shared with me photos and medals that they had from a family member who had served and returned from the war, but whose life was certainly marked by that experience. We remember today that we do have family members in our history, some perhaps closer in our memory, whose lives have been affected by violence. Today, we take time to remember them. We begin by remembering our country in the singing of O Canada. As you are able, you are invited to remain standing for this time of remembering. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We remember Archie D. Beaton, Heath E. Beaton, Vincent Carr, Arthur Collett, Percy Farrar, Murchison Gordon, Elmer Mabee, John MacPhail, Heath W. McQuarrie, Patrick McManus, Ernest Norton, Bertram Penphrase, Harry W. Stewart, and John L. Wood.
Thank you.
Let us continue in prayer. Today, O God, we remember times of war, and we are saddened to remember people who died while in active service, also mothers and fathers, children and animals. We remember their friends and family members who still feel deep grief. Let us continue in prayer. Today, O God, we remember times of war, and we are saddened to remember people who died while in active service, also mothers and fathers, children and animals. We remember their friends and family members who still feel deep grief. We remember people who still suffer the physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual wounds of war, and those for whom depression and post-traumatic stress is still a reality. We remember that bombs destroy schools, factories, churches, and houses. We remember all who are driven from their homes and who become refugees, living in camps without hope of a new life. Peace-loving God, while we remember all the horrible things that happen in war, give us the courage to be compassionate, to find ways to support those who suffer because of wars past and present. We remember hate crimes that continue to fuel divisions between your people, and which create a sense of otherness which separates us from one another. O God, who is one, lead us away from labeling one another, from responding from a place of fear to anyone we have perceived as different. Make us people who are willing to learn to live peacefully together, to share that none will be hungry or homeless, to solve our problems by talking, not fighting, to respect all forms of life, and to use our knowledge to save life and not to destroy it, as those who follow your Son, the Prince of Peace, we pray with hope. Amen. Remaining seated, let us sing our next hymn, In Suffering Love.
From Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, verses 9 to 13. You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaim to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you, believers. And also reading from Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 12. Jesus denounces scribes and Pharisees. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens hard to bear, and they lay them on the shoulders of others, but they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have people call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted." Here ends the reading.
Let us pray. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts in all of our hearts draw us closer to each other and to you, O God. Amen. When we consider the two readings for today, it's interesting the two contrasting messages about how people respond in times of strife. Matthew wrote near the end of the first century. That was a time when Jerusalem had been destroyed and the Jewish population was dispersed and scattered through an increasingly pluralistic society. Many of their leaders were concerned that their people would forget their identity as God's people. They were afraid the Israelites would forget and become absorbed into the society around them and lose their unique heritage. Thus, when Matthew has Jesus describe the Pharisees as going to great lengths to stand out, it is important for us to understand their purpose was to be a visual reminder for their people of their uniqueness as a race. They wore overlarge phylacteries, that was small boxes on their arms and forehead that contained a small parchment with a scripture verse, and that was used to guide their prayer times 3 times a day. They wore excessive fringes on their garments to stand out and to indicate their office. When we read Matthew's gospel, we need to be really careful and cautious because he had certain prejudices that come through in his writings. He has Jesus lump all scribes and Pharisees together. Now, we certainly know, all of us, from our life experiences that whether you're talking about hockey players, farmers, politicians, or actors, it's impossible to lump one group of people all together. People are very diverse, whatever group they belong to. Actions and behaviors of some in the group do not define the action and character of the entire group. So when Jesus is describing the scribes and Pharisees in this story, it's important for us to recognize he probably noticed the behavior of a few, and he's holding them up as a challenge for his listeners. The ones who are described are ones who are not just concerned with preserving their people's heritage. They were more concerned about drawing attention to themselves and maintaining their power. They wanted the best seats when they went to a banquet or when they were in any public area or gathering. They wanted to be called by their titles and to be honored whenever they went somewhere. And so that is a different thing. In the synagogue, they sat on what was called Moses' seat, and that was traditional because that's where the instructor sat to be able to teach the students. And Jesus valued their instructions. He told his listeners, listen to what the scribes and Pharisees teach you. They are important teachings. What he challenges in a few of them is that they don't practice what they preach. Jesus says they place heavy burdens on the people and don't lift a finger. They expect the people to do all of the work of helping others in the community, and they themselves do nothing. That is the challenge of these individuals he observed. A very different picture is painted in the church in Thessalonica. There, Paul had gone and shared the story of Jesus, and a small community of faith was started, a small Christian church in a home. And as the people began to share their message of following a different king than Caesar, they became perceived as a threat. And so soldiers went out to arrest them. Paul wasn't there. And the people of the community were arrested. But because no full charges could be brought against them, they were released. Yet still their lives were risky and scary. And so Paul, who had gone on to other communities, wrote a letter to them to encourage them. And in it, he reminded them of how he and the other leaders who had shared with them shared the burden, that they worked side by side with them in their efforts. He shared with them the importance of encouraging one another, of supporting each other, comforting, urging each other on in the faith. And he expressed gratitude for the people there and what they were doing. What a contrast in the two different stories. One grasping for security, the other getting down to the work that needed to be done, encouraging, helping one another, and being grateful for what is accomplished. As we approach Remembrance Day and the various gatherings that will be held this next week, we are reminded of people who have lived and continue to live in times of strife and tremendous suffering. We acknowledge the still devastating experiences that are prevalent in our world right now. And how do we respond? Will we simply speak the words of remembrance like we did today and then go on with our lives? Will we be tempted to hold tight to our own sense of security and leave the hard work to others? Several years ago, I attended a lodge banquet with Paul, and the speaker that year was a person who had been through World War II. And he shared with us what his training was like. He talked about being bounced from place to place when he was sent overseas. He spoke of losing comrades and of divisions being reshuffled to fill in the spots where those had been killed. He spoke of explosions going off and his body being tossed 25 feet into a field, of the daily fear of never knowing if you would see another day. He described the cold and the challenge of living 3 years in a tent. But as he shared his story, he also punctuated it with a sense of humor to show us there were also moments of lightness that he experienced even in the midst of the horror of war. Although the retelling of his story re-traumatized him each time, he chose to keep telling his story so that the rest of us would remember the cost of war. Another person that I met was in my very first pastoral charge, and Sam was not able to speak about his experiences in the war. The trauma was so extreme for him, he couldn't talk with people in a general way at all. But he could work with wood. And so Sam had a little wood shop outside of his home that he built, and he worked and fashioned beautiful pieces of furniture. That was the work he could do. And he would come in every now and then when I was having coffee and visiting with his wife, and he would sit and drink his coffee, and then he would bring me in a piece of something that he wanted to share. And he would give that to me, and that was all the communication we had. But it was his way of finding a way to share beauty in the world. In a later congregation, Don was the veteran that I met. And he talked a little bit about his experiences, but it was mainly to show how they became a motivation for him. When he returned to Canada, he was determined to do good and to shed light wherever he was. And so he became active in community organizations, in local politics, and he steadfastly worked through the rest of his life to make the world a better place for other people. How do we choose to live through times of suffering, whether it is personal, in the community around us, or in our world? Do we hold tight to security? Do we point out what's wrong and expect everybody else to deal with it? Wait for the politicians to manage it? Or are we willing to do that hard work side by side, encouraging one another, of seeking to build peace? Some of our advocates and workers within the United Church have established 40 days of engagement for the ending of racism within the church and within the world. It's going on right now. A lot of us are probably not even aware of it. But you can go to the United Church website and you can read stories and you can hear people present to help us begin to break down the walls that divide us. One of the stories I'd like to share today is by Lillian McChico Blakey. This is her story. It was in the early hours of November the 11th of 2022 that my 92-year-old father died in Toronto with my mother in a chair beside him. The significance of the date didn't hit me until later in the day. It was Remembrance Day. 104 years after the end of World War I, what was supposed to be the war to end all wars, except that it wasn't. My father was a Canadian child of World War II internment of Japanese Canadians. Fingerprinted and registered, they were issued ID cards to restrict their movements. His family was incarcerated in Tajmi, That's the largest of 8 internment camps of uninsulated tar paper shacks, hastily built specifically to contain over 2,600 British Columbians of Japanese ancestry. They were isolated in a narrow, heavily forested valley and surrounded by the high Cascade Mountains. Tashmi was as good as a prison. White rice was rationed during the war, and when a supply arrived in Tashmi, it was usually mixed with rough barley to make it go further. To my father, this unpleasant grain mixture was the taste and texture of internment. Short grain rice is supposed to stick together, not fall apart. Its texture is meant to be smooth and even. World War II officially ended in 1945. No longer officially enemies, interned Canadians of Japanese ancestry still remained alien in their country of birth. They were still persecuted. When the war ended, BC and Canada made sure they were not allowed to return to BC, where my father and his siblings were born. So the family, now homeless, moved to Ontario rather than go to war-ravaged Japan that they didn't even know. Landing in Scarborough, Ontario, because the city of Toronto would not allow them to get off the train, my father's family were unwanted asylum seekers in their own country. It wasn't until 1949 that fingerprint identification cards were no longer enforced. As soon as he could, my father burned his ID card, a hated symbol of Canadian racism that superseded his Canadian birth certificate. I wish I had asked him to say more while he was still alive. I wish I had asked him how he learned to deal with the anger of injustice that had shaped the arc of his life and his family's. I wish so many of his stories had not remained unspoken. Lillian Machiko Blakey is a gifted Japanese-Canadian artist, and she created the piece that's on the slide, Sticky Rice. It's a 15-foot drawing, and there are on it 22, it extends over various billboards, there are 22,000 grains of rice painted into that painting. Each grain represents a Japanese-Canadian who endured injustices during forcible World War II uprooting, forced labor, family separation, incarceration, exile and dispossession, and it honors those who died along the way. She tells us short grain rice sticks together, and in the middle you can see a part of it that is short and compacted together. It reminds us as a powerful metaphor of a targeted exiled community forced together under the pressure of fear-mongering, race hatred, and abuse of political power. She reminds us God's gift of life is not just for one community or for one moment in time. It is for all people over all time. Refugees fleeing wars, displaced persons, asylum seekers, immigrants leaving political oppression, and persecuted 2SLGBTQIA+ people. There are many people who carry heavy burdens in today's world, and Jesus calls us to share in the work of lifting those burdens, to free one another that we may live in peace with justice for all. Are we willing to hear the difficult stories of veterans and survivors of various traumas and to return to our daily lives motivated to work for change? Are we willing to write letters of encouragement and support to others who are working on our behalf, whether it's in our own community, through some of the organizations? Have we ever thought to write them and say thank you, as Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, thank you for your work, encouraging them and supporting them through our words? Are we able to express our thanks to family members for actions they have taken? Are we willing to be educated and to find ways to share goodness, like Lillian with her art, like Sam with his wood that he shared, with Don who worked in his community? There are so many ways we can respond to strife in our own lives and communities and world. May we each find our way to act for peace, for justice, and for hope. Thanks be to God. Amen. In our offering time, we share of what we have to lighten the load of someone who needs our care. So we dedicate our offering as we sing the piece, What Does the Lord Require of You? Now, a little bit of direction here. We're going to sing verse 1, 2, and 3, and then all of those who identify as male, you're invited to sing, What Does the Lord Require of You? Those who identify as female, you may sing To Seek Justice the second time we sing through. We'll see what happens. Everyone. That was beautiful. See the harmony. We can be different, but come together and create something beautiful. Our next hymn for the healing of the nations is a prayer hymn. Let us sing this as our pastoral prayer today. We give thanks to Tom Albright for placing the wreath today and to Richard for having placed the various items around the sanctuary to help us enter into that spirit of remembrance. Thank you to Mary Heckbert for reading for us today. And we are grateful for life, for celebrating life with those who are achieving certain milestones. Today, we recognize Jack has a birthday, and Catherine has a birthday. I don't know if it's exactly today or right around. I believe it's a special number called 80. Yeah. So many blessings to you. And George, you can take home our blessings to Catherine, please. As we go, may the peace of God surround us, the love of Jesus fill us, and the encouragement of the Holy Spirit guide us in the work we do.